All right, I think I'm going to go ahead and get started with the presentation. So as you guys make your way over, I'm just going to recap on some of the things that we always like to start the meetings off with. So welcome back, guys. Our tonight's agenda is really, this is our last committee meeting, so we're looking at finalizing a recommendation, having you guys finalize a recommendation to be presented to the school board. We're going to do our same format and have some small group work after I do a little PowerPoint presentation, and then we'll have a discussion and see if we want to make any adjustments to the maps before you guys vote on a recommendation. So here we are in our final meeting. You can see we've come quite a ways and had a lot of back and forth, a lot of debate and discussion, and a lot of good thorough review of the options and the ways to resolve some of the challenges here in this area. After this meeting, the board will be the recommendation will be presented to the board in February of next year. So there's going to be a little bit of a time period between tonight and the board recommendation, and then there will be a board hearing where the board is going to invite the public to come voice their thoughts about the recommendation, and that's scheduled to be at Lock Raven High School on February 26th at 6:30 p.m. And there's a snow date identified for that. And then the board is expected to vote in March of next year on a recommendation for this area. Another, just a recap, why are we here and what are our objectives? Working with a community-based group and doing an open and transparent process with the focus on trying to provide capacity relief at Pleasant Plains Elementary, supporting diversity among schools that reflects the community and the system, and then create viable and successful boundaries to effectively utilize available capacity at adjacent schools. So looking at our study area and trying to make sure that things are equitable in terms of utilization and numbers of seats that are being used or available at the buildings. Also looking to other considerations to consider are maintaining the continuity of neighborhoods, looking at the impact of transportation and pedestrian patterns, minimizing the times any individual students are reassigned, looking at long-term enrollment and capacity trends and future capital plans to be mindful of that. Feeder boundaries, which we have data to look at the impact on feeders. And then additional considerations are using geographic features such as railroads, creeks, major highways when you look at drawing lines and things like that. Some follow-up requests.
Something that parents specifically asked me to ask, so I'm asking. This seems a good time. So Rule 1280 was revised in July of this year, but this study was voted on to proceed in June. And I have had several parents ask me why there's a discrepancy there, and so I'm asking whoever why there's a discrepancy. The original rule listed all the considerations at equal value, and now the rule lists the efficient use of capacity and maintaining diversity as the primary, and then the rest is secondary, whereas prior to July of this year, they were all weighted equally. So that's a question that I've had, and I don't know how to answer because I'm not on the school board.
Sure. Did somebody maybe give some background or history to that? Is any from the school district? I think it was how it's framed as a primary considerations and secondary considerations.
I have both versions.
Okay, and I think I did see some comments about that. So we will the district will follow up on that, and look to address that question. At least we'll state that since this is your last committee meeting, we'll state that with the board and on the website. But I would say that, you know, there are primary and secondary considerations, but really you need to look at all of these all of these considerations as you evaluate the options. And I'd say that you know, that they are all important and need to be evaluated as you consider one option versus another. And the best plan will be one that addresses and touches on the primary and secondary considerations as a whole. Some follow-up, why have long-term enrollment projections not been part of the committee deliberations? And one of the things with this slide is stating is that, as we know, Pleasant Plains has immediate relief. And so this is really not designed to be a long-term solution. It's more something to give Pleasant Plains some immediate relief for the next school year so that they can have some breathing room and have some space to be able to educate students and not have their students in overcrowded, very extremely overcrowded situations. So the objective of this is to provide that immediate relief to the school. Long-term relief measures will be considered in developing the fiscal, the 2021 capital plan and the 10-year capital improvement plan. So we have given you information through the course of the study to help shed some light on this, but this is really designed more as a measure to help give immediate relief to Pleasant Plains as soon as possible. And as we've discussed, the other measures and the other relief strategies that the district goes through to try to help provide relief, looking at capacity analysis and room use recommendations and relocatables and things like that, have already been exhausted. So there really is no other option for Pleasant Plains other than looking at trying to assign students to a different school to a change in how the students are being assigned. Has the impact of future development on enrollment been adequately considered? So the district projects student yields from new development by using historical data for similar development types in the area. So they sample housing types in this area to determine how many students are coming out of housing developments, whether it's single, multifamily, rental, owner, how many students are coming out of existing homes in the area, and that's used as a gauge to understand how many kids could come out of future or planned developments. The most recent student yield study was completed in 2017, and that study did incorporate analysis of developments since 1995, so trying to capture a good bulk of the developments, residential developments that have been constructed. And student yields were calculated using an average of 2013 to 15 school years so that you could also not only track point time, but also understand that there's ebbs and flows and numbers of students coming in, so that's why they're using a time period. You can find this on the more information and methodology for the study on the 2017 student yield study on the Boundary Study website, so that study is linked up there. And then the impact of development on long-term enrollment will inform capital planning in the area. So as they're continuing to study the needs of the county and knowing that this is one section of the county and the district has to really address the needs and balance the needs of address the needs of the of communities across this entire county, they do look at the long-term enrollment trends and the impact on development as they consider the needs and prioritize those needs. Why have state rated capacities been updated? In response to the state legislation, House Bill 1783, the BCPS began a comprehensive review of state rated capacities across the system in September 2018. State Department of Planning and Interagency on School Construction requested current SRC numbers as part of their effort to complete facilities assessment to improve facility planning across Maryland. So the state requested that. And then 67 state-rated capacity updates have been submitted to the MDP during this time period. So there have been a number of schools' capacity numbers that have been modified and updated as they continue to review room uses and how buildings are being utilized. And so that's an update on state-rated capacities. And they have been evaluated for this study area and some of the work, per some of the work that we've been doing. Why were other schools not included in the study? And we've covered this a couple of times, but just another recap on this. Is that the schools in the adjacent to this area, other schools around here, do not have adequate capacity to provide capacity relief. This is an updated table that reflects the most recent state-rated capacities and the September 30th, 2019 enrollment. And you can see where the schools that are adjacent, that they are all primarily running over with the exception of Cromwell Valley. And Cromwell Valley has, as we've discussed, it's a partial magnet. It has a walkable zone immediately around that school, and the remainder of the building is populated by through an application process, which is still building out. So that's why it looks on paper at 84%, but that building is still, there's still, it's still not through the full maturation process to have the full magnet program in place there. So as that continues, and once that's complete, it's expected that Cromwell Valley will be full. But you can see Halstead and Hampton are the two buildings that have some, that are in the green, although they are on, you know, on the higher side. Halstead certainly is at 98%, and Hampton's at 86% utilization, which does suggest that Hampton could help provide some capacity relief to Pleasant Plains, which is at about 125, almost 125% utilization. And I've discussed, I kind of touched on Cromwell Valley, which was a question that was asked, why is the Cromwell Valley magnet not included in the study? And in 2015, the district announced its goals to reestablish the magnet program at Cromwell Valley. There was a boundary study conducted in 2016 that created that walkable area around Cromwell Valley, and then that students were drawn from Hampton, actually, as part of that process. And about 65 to 70 kindergarten students are accepted in the program each year. And once the magnet program is fully enrolled for all grades, it's projected that that building will be will reach full enrollment. Touching on travel time, estimated travel times to Hampton Elementary School for the Office of Transportation. And so these are some various planning blocks, and I can always pull these up, and you have them also in your materials to show you the times that it takes to get to Hampton Elementary for your benefit so that you can get an idea on the impact on transportation and distance. Current rides for Hampton Elementary range between 25 and 35 minutes, and you could see that all of the areas that we're considering to move are within that threshold of what they're currently, how long students are currently on a bus to get to Hampton Elementary. And so I think that's probably my biggest observation with this is that there's nothing that's really, anything that you're considering is far outside of what the normal travel times are to Hampton Elementary. So we have the same three drafts. We didn't make any changes at the last meeting, but we're bringing them back. And there has been a lot of ongoing input from the public and considerations. I think from what I've gathered, a lot of the key information, the key concerns that I've taken and heard from this is that concerns that Hampton Elementary is gaining too many students and that we're shifting a problem around and that that although we're resolving overcrowding at Pleasant Plains, we may be creating an overcrowding problem at Hampton. And that's kind of, I think, the crux of the concerns that we're hearing from communities. But it's a tough job for you guys to consider how to give Pleasant Plains some relief and at what magnitude or how much relief you give to Pleasant Plains. But I would encourage you tonight, if you feel that the options right now have too many students added to Hampton Elementary, you could consider making adjustments, maybe backing off of a couple planning blocks to still give Pleasant Plains some relief, but maybe not add so many to Hampton. That may be something for you to consider to address those concerns if you feel that those concerns are valid and best adhere to our overall objectives and considerations. Your data and information does have all of the September enrollment as of September 30, 2019. So your packets and information all do show you the data as of the most recent enrollment information. Looking at the options and utilization, you can see option A, all the buildings are over 100%, and you can see the imbalance that exists now with Pleasant Plains at 125. Hampton goes from 86 to 103 at option A. Pleasant Plains goes down to 101, and so that is some of the concerns that were sort of piggybacks on some of the concerns that we've heard about too many students in being added to Hampton, especially with the future growth potential.
Sorry, I think I'm the self-appointed squeaky wheel tonight.
That's
fine. One of the other questions that parents have been asking me from Hampton is if a reduction too deep of a reduction in Pleasant Plains will, hinder their priority for further construction, which I think most people recognize is what they really need. Because even if Hampton takes 200 of their students, next year they're going to be right back at 100%. So the question is, are they going to fall out of their queue in the priority if we're too overzealous in this? But then,
yeah, I mean, and I do remember seeing that too. That, you know, the concern is that if we provide too much relief to Pleasant Plains, will they then no longer be eligible for capital improvements? I think that the district looks at a variety of things to help provide to understand where they identify needs. Overcrowding is certainly one where they decide where they have to expand, but they also look at the condition of the facilities and things like that as they prioritize those needs. And so I can't say that it would or would not have any impact. As what they try to do when you get through this, do this work, you try to first create as much equitable balance of utilization as you can. Make use of all the space that you have available first before you start looking at adding a building, putting dollars into adding capacity. I think that it's evident that no matter what we do, we're still looking at 102% utilization in this area. And so no matter what, it's still going to be on the radar of an area that is in need of capacity relief. And they know it's not going to help. This isn't a long-term solution. Is there anything else that I missed or anything that you guys want to add from staff?
That question is addressed in the FAQ also that you have available in your packets. And that's online Mr. Cropper said, it's not, they look at the total need in the area, and as you can see from those charts of the adjacent schools, there is a need for seats in this general area. And that 10-year facility plan that the county is now working on in conjunction with the county executive will identify where those projects will go. But in the general area, projects are needed and seats are needed. And so it's not going to jeopardize a capital project in the area because we need more seats in the area.
You could see, oh, yeah. Sorry. No, you're fine. No, nuts. This is all good. We want to make sure you're...
So I guess a follow-up question is, I'm under the impression that schools are only eligible for capital projects about every 10 years, and Hampton has already had one within the last 10 years, so I'm not sure what that would then look like for them. So assuming that Hampton then takes all these students and is no longer eligible for a few more years relative to other schools that haven't had any capacity building in terms of capital projects. Is that true or not true? I don't know.
No, you're fine.
It's
not every 10 years or anything like that. What the state has in their regulations is really you just need to show the need. You need a seat need, and then projects are identified, so the areas are evaluated, and part of that 10-year facility plan that they're looking to develop is to look at the long-term projections. Where are people trending? Where are the seat needs? Where can a project go that has, like Mr. Cropper said, the facility conditions are there. We need the seats. It can address multiple overcrowdings in the area and how that would work. But it's not limited to every 10 years. If you're familiar with the high school capacity study, there's projects in there that were proposed that have had projects within the last 10 years. There are certain high schools that have had projects in the last 10 years that are included in that plan to have additional projects. I mean, it's just the plan, but hopefully all that will come back up in this 10-year plan. And we encourage everyone to come out during that process and voice your concerns and express, you know, what your thoughts are on that.
So you could see in option B, you have a little bit better adherence to some of the concerns that we've heard Pleasant Plains doesn't get as much relief, but Hampton doesn't go as high. It's at 101%. And Halstead is unaffected in option B. It stays at 98%. And then in option C, Halstead gets a little more capacity relief. And Hampton's at 102, and Pleasant Plains is at 107. So Hampton, Pleasant Plains doesn't get as much capacity relief in C as it does in B or in A. And Hampton is at 102 in option C. Really no substantial impact on the percent minority for the options. You can see Hampton's does go up, and every option's currently at 39% minority, and it goes up in every single option. The other two schools are primarily unaffected in terms of the overall percent of total minority in the buildings. ELL, the same as an impact, a slight impact to Hampton Elementary, but not as much of an impact to Halstead and Pleasant Plains. But Hampton's percent of farms and percent ELL do go up in every option as a result of some of the planning blocks that have been moved or considered to move in that option. Numbers of students impacted, you can see how it breaks down. Option B impacts the fewest, and then option C is the second fewest, and A impacts the most, the largest number of students. Feeder patterns, you do have some feeder pattern splits in this area that exist at middle school level, and remember, we're not here, we can't make adjustments to the middle schools, but currently your Hampton split three ways, and Pleasant Plains is split three ways. In option A, Hampton gets split four ways, and that this is primarily that small area that's in Pleasant Plains now that's feeding into, I think it goes to Dumbarton Middle School, maybe. It's but Pine Grove Middle School. So you could see that with that area getting picked up, that northeastern area section of Pleasant Plains that gets moved into Hampton creates that four-way split that you see in these options. And then in option C, that area stays in Pleasant Plains, so that's why you see that split there at Pine Grove. Some of the feeder pattern data. Just a quick recap on the three options before we let you guys break into some small groups. This option does have the best balance overall. If you look at all three schools, comparing all three, it has the best balance of utilization. It does provide an improvement in the demographic diversity at Hampton, and feeder patterns are improved slightly. This does impact the most students. As you could see that we had this area is moved out of Halstead into Hampton, and then this region right here is Pleasant Plains that gets moved into Hampton. This is Pleasant Plains as well that goes into Hampton, and then there are some areas that are Pleasant Plains down here that get moved into Halstead. So there's a little bit of give and take and back and forth adjustment with option A. Option B doesn't move this line between Halstead and Pleasant Plains here. Halstead remains unaffected in this option, but the areas around Pleasant Plains here are moved into Hampton as well as this region right here. This one impacts the fewest number of students. You still get the same improvements in demographic diversity for Hampton. The feeder patterns are a little bit cleaner, like we've discussed, and Halstead doesn't have a boundary change in this one. But Pleasant Plains is still over 100%, and Hampton Elementary feeds into four different middle schools. In option C, you have a little bit of a difference here. There's a little bit of area moved from Pleasant Plains into Halstead. And this is all walkable area, so that was, you guys were looking at moving some of these in to increase the number of walkers. And then this area right here that's in Halstead feeds into Hampton with this region on the west end of the Pleasant Plains zone. But this area stays in Pleasant Plains in option C. You do improve the demographic diversity of Hampton, favorable elementary and middle school feeders, but Pleasant Plains is at 100% in this option, and Hampton feeds into three different middle schools in this particular option. You guys have any questions about the any of the material that I've covered so far, any other questions that you wanted to bring up? Not, this isn't the last time for questions, but if you have anything at this moment. So we're going to have you guys work in your small groups again. Like I said, we haven't modified these options. You'll see you have a sheet of paper on your table under the little post-it notes that talk about some of the advantages and limitations of the option and also potential adjustments to the options to make them better. You could consider if there are any changes to be made to these options, you could give us notes on that and things that you may want to do. One of the things, like I had mentioned, is if you feel like, I know that there's a lot of heartburn with this committee about providing relief, but then also creating an additional challenge at Hampton. If you feel like that's an issue, you could look at these options and try to figure out, is there a way to give Pleasant Plains relief, but maybe not give them as much with the focus on not overcrowding Hampton? And it would be one thing that you could potentially consider. Principals are acting as facilitators and recorders of the conversations, and we'll give you about 20 minutes to work in your groups, okay? So with that said, I'll let you guys get to work, and we'll be checking on you. Let's see. I know there's a lot of good conversations going, but maybe about 5 minutes, and then we'll regroup and recap on some of your thoughts. About 5 minutes. I was thinking that we would tape up at their markup. I got the tape. We'll see when they come up. Okay, so why don't we have a discussion? Like, let's hear some of your thoughts as you guys were deliberating the options and talking about the options. I saw a couple of different conversations and things going on with the different groups. Really good, constructive conversation. You want to start, guys? You want to, or let the red group go first? Okay. Let's hear what the red group has to say, and any of your thoughts that you guys were discussing.
Oh, jeez. All right.
What do you want me to just sort of describe what we...
Yeah, what were your thoughts about, you know, as you looked at all three options, what were your
thoughts?
All right,
well, we have an X on option A.
Okay.
Ding. Option B, I think, was the one that everybody was looking at the most because it's the least overcrowding of Hampton. Halsted remains about the same. It keeps the church daycare situation intact, which was a big concern for Halsted. There's a particular daycare that provides transportation to and from Halsted that they really want to keep within the boundary for simplicity, and it's a lot of kiddos. And then the weakness is the fourth middle school for Hampton, and so a potential change would put PB231 at Pleasant Plains, that little weird claw finger.
Was that this one right here?
Yeah.
Okay.
So that was the one where we're like,
okay.
And then my sheet also has an X on C. So
you guys didn't like, you really looked more at B and
mostly
ways
I think
improve.
We sort of narrowed in on B, and then the one option about B that C had was that finger in the fourth middle school situation.
Okay.
So.
And that 231 adjustment does resolve that fourth split too,
right,
as well.
So it was like B except for that potentially.
Okay.
231, that little claw.
So option B with planning block 231 and Pleasant Plains.
Potentially. It says potential.
Potentially, yeah. Any other thoughts that you guys had? I know that would put Hampton below 100%, you know, they would be below 100%. It wouldn't give Pleasant Plains as much relief, but they still get adequate or a good amount of relief. So, any other thoughts from your group? Okay. Thank you very much. What about you guys? Let's hear some of your thoughts.
I got it. Well, we also agreed with you on option A. It doesn't help Pleasant Plains, and it doesn't leave room at Hampton for future development in the Hampton area. We looked at option B, kind of changed option B around a little bit, moved planning block 201 and 202 back to Pleasant Plains, and then we looked at option C. Then we looked at the numbers, and we figured that by doing that, we would pretty much match the numbers in option C. So we thought, well, what's the point? Yeah, you know, option C seems like it provides relief to Pleasant Plains, not enough relief to Pleasant Plains, but it also leaves room at Hampton for future development in their area. We also saw that, the feeder patterns, is that option C? Yeah, it has... Option C, only Hampton will only feed into three middle schools instead of four, which we saw as a plus. And also a plus for option C is it has Halsted as mainly walkers instead of having buses.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And you mentioned for B, planning blocks 201 and 202, which are these two, but I think you're also including 203, which is a zero pop block to connect everything if you were to do that, right?
Oh yeah. So I mean that's all shopping center, so it's never going to have any
no
students.
Population.
Yeah.
But for the so we can make sure that we capture it perfectly. It's 201, 202, and 203 is what you had colored.
Right.
Okay. And then did you have any changes to option C noted, or you were just more identifying some of the advantages and limitations of that option?
Yeah, we didn't talk about any changes
no
to option C.
Option C. Okay. So any other thoughts or conversations you guys were having about the maps or anything else that you wanted to add? So I think that both of these, so we've got two adjustments to B, 231, one is B with 231 at Pleasant Plains, and the other one is B with two, which I'll just point to, is this would go purple in one consideration, and everything else remains the same as B with B. The other consideration is this would stay green, and these right here would go purple. And so that, and which are, these are both currently in Pleasant Plains. And that's 201, 202, and 203. So we can add those. Do you guys have any thoughts about their considerations and vice versa? Do you guys have any concerns with either group was talking about possibly putting on the table?
Well, just I think a clarification that planning block 201 and 202, we kind of decided that that's as far as plan C, moving that out of plan B matches plan C as far as the numbers go.
Okay.
So we kind of said it's ridiculous to make that change in option B because it's
okay.
The numbers pretty much match option C.
Okay. So you were looking at it and considering that move, but then when you were all said and done, you concluded that it wasn't viable.
Exactly.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So that was just more of a discovery, and that's kind of what you had thought, but your conclusion was not to bring that forward because for those reasons.
Correct.
Okay. So the only adjustment then that, what are your thoughts from this group over here about moving that back into Pleasant Plains? Their thoughts were puts Hampton under 100%, reduces that four-way split for Hampton, and Hampton would not feed split to four different middle schools, and then also reducing the number of students impacted and leaving Halstead unaffected. Do you guys have any concerns about that thought or consideration? We could put it on the table and see how the votes fall, as that can be sort of an additional option that we could put on the docket for considering. Okay. So let me just go through a couple of these, and then we'll let Mike do some edits to the voting procedure here. So you guys are tasked with providing a recommendation that best meets the overall objectives and considerations, both primary and secondary, like we discussed. The final decision on this is made by the Board of Education. So everything is draft. And what you're doing is taking a draft recommendation to the superintendent, to the community superintendent, and then that's going up the chain and being recommended to the board for their consideration. So it's still draft until that board approves a plan. Everything is still draft. There are additional opportunities for public input even once this the committee's process is complete. The board has a public hearing procedure that goes with the recommendation, so there still are opportunities for public input even once once your committee work is complete. And then the board also has been following the process. They have access to all the information as we share all the data that we share with you and the public. It's all available out there for everybody, including the Board of Education. So a couple guidelines on voting. The principals can't vote. They're not non-voting members. We're looking for one scenario. So we'd like the recommendation is one map to move forward to the board. And just remember when you make this vote, just to consider those goals, study goals, and the Rule 1280 considerations. The best plan will be one that adheres to those goals and recommendations as best, the considerations as best as possible. We have the active vote devices. You guys have your little clickers there. We're going to conduct voting in two rounds. The first vote will be used to reduce the options to two. And then the two options receiving the highest number of votes will be advanced to a final vote. Okay? So, and then you'll have the opportunity to discuss the results of the first vote prior to your final vote. And then once that's done, the final vote will be used to select the scenario that you're going to recommend, which will be voting on two options. The option that gets the most votes will be recommended to the Board of Education. Okay. So we're going to add, we have A, B, and C right now, but we're going to add option B with planning block 231 at Pleasant Plains. So that's the adjustment that you guys discussed. So now that's that would be a D on your clicker if that was the one that you wanted. So the first round is to select the option that you vote to recommend to the Board of Education. So if it's unanimous, then we don't need to go through a second vote.
Could we see how that changes the numbers for that option?
Could we run those, Chris?
Yes, we did.
Okay, so it would be 21 students added to Pleasant Plains and 21 out of Hampton.
Okay, under the standard scenario B, Hampton was 9 students over and Pleasant Plains was 35 students over. With that modification, that puts Hampton at 12 students under, Pleasant Plains at 56 students over. That's utilization percentages before the change of 101% for Hampton and 106% for Pleasant Plains. After the modification, that's 98% per Hampton utilization and 110% for Pleasant Plains. Minority enrollment, before the modification, 45% for Hampton, 81% for Pleasant Plains. After the modification, 44.5% for Hampton, 81% for Pleasant Plains. Farms data, before the modification, 24% Hampton, 63% Pleasant Plains. After the modification, 22% Hampton, 63% Pleasant Plains. And ELL, before the modification, 6% Hampton, 18% Pleasant Plains. After the modification, 6% Hampton, 18% Pleasant Plains.
You guys have any questions about that or any discussion about that, some of the statistics with this D selection? Okay, so you guys ready to vote? All right, so this first one is I vote to recommend the following option to the Board of Education. And so you pick whichever letter you feel is best meets the overall objectives and considerations, and we'll see how the votes fall. Okay? I think we're ready. Okay. So we have a tie between B and C. And option D did not, or the one that we had just discussed, didn't make it to the next level. So these are the two options that we have to choose from. Options B and C are the two that made it to the next level. You guys need some time to look at the maps and data anymore, or are you guys ready to make a vote on the next round of votes? Okay, so with that said, we'll move on to the vote. The option I vote to recommend the Board of Education. Option B, you pick B, or option C, you would pick C. All right. Okay. So option B had 62.5%. Option C had 37.5% of the votes. And so option B is the scenario that will be recommended to the board as the committee's recommendation. When we do tell the story to the public or to the board, when we present this recommendation to the board, we will let them know that wasn't a unanimous decision, and that how things kind of played out in terms of how we got to the recommendation. We'll share that there were some There was some favor for C, as well as even some for option D, for the adjustment that was considered. So we will kind of walk the board through the path of how you guys got to your recommendation. Couple of just next steps. The board will be, the recommendation is going to come in February the 11th at the Greenwood campus. The building, it's not the big mansion on the hill, but down at the bottom of the hill. And then there's a board hearing February 26th at 6:30 p.m. at Lock Raven High School. Not here, but it's at the high school. You guys don't have to come to these as a committee. We've asked a lot of you to come to all these meetings, and we really appreciate your time. But you're encouraged and welcome to come to this so that you could see how the board considers the maps and the recommendation and from there. And the board is expected to vote on Tuesday, March 10th at 6:30 p.m. Do you guys have any questions or anything like that before we let you guys go home? Well, thank you so much for all your time and hard work on this process and not making popular decisions, but we really appreciate it. We hope you guys have a happy holiday and have a great week. Thank you very much.